The film takes place in the future, and something happened on Earth, some kind of an environmental disaster. It's such a strange environment. It was a great abstract setting.
Action!
My experience of stepping on the soundstage, it was just incredible. You're in a completely different world.
If what we find safe, I'll send for you.
The characters are all very, very honest and real. It's not just science fiction. It is the characters and their human side.
We're taking subjects which are futuristic, but then giving it almost like a documentary reality. This is a very exciting combination.
She was called Mother Earth.
There used to be tropical jungles and mighty forests breathing oxygen for us.
And we couldn't stay?
Now we plundered everything she offered.
The colony is set in the distant future, where after a catastrophic event on Earth forced the elite of the planet to leave and to settle down on another planet called Kepler-209. After generations of living on this planet, they have a problem there. They can't reproduce anymore. They are not children anymore. So the colony is about a mission back to Earth.
What the primary sort of drive of the characters is to propagate the human species, to build a new Earth for the human race.
How long until the tide comes, Becky?
6 hours and 45 minutes.
Okay, we'll use that time to gather data. Let's gear up.
I'm gonna do the first recon on my own.
Blake is this astronaut from planet Kepler who is sent back to Earth to verify whether there is a new habitat for her people on Earth.
What does Kepler teach us, Louise? We will not let our emotions guide us. We do this for the many.
The society on Kepler is trained to not be emotional, to be very focused on the survival of Kepler. But we find out during the story is that she has another emotional motivation for this journey, because we learn her father was sent to Earth on the first mission and she hopes to find out what happened to him.
What people love to see is emotions and the relationship that Blake has with her dad, and her wanting to know what happened to her dad is something that a lot of people can relate to. This is not only a science fiction movie with stunts and guns, it has a lot of heart.
Okay, and action!
You make the characters believable by casting. You just try to get the actor or the actress who gives the most authentic performance to that character. With Nora, she had this determination that we wanted for the character. Then when we started preparing the movie, she was so dedicated to the role. She trained a lot to portray that character as believable as possible.
I remember when I was auditioning, I was like, man, if I get the part, it's gonna be a very tough one. And when I got the part, I prepared myself. I trained. I prepared myself psychologically.
We should test.
It's too soon.
We've been away from Kepler's radiation 563 days. It's worth a shot.
With Nora, we talked a lot on how does she portray that character that is trained to suppress her emotions.
Negative.
So what she does is she lets this emotion come up, but then she suppresses them.
At least it's a prospect.
Moving on.
This character is a beautiful, interesting arc. In the beginning, you don't really know if she really has emotion. And when she lands on Earth, she starts having her TSH levels recover. And the longer she's on Earth, the more she starts having these human feelings. So it's got a real emotional journey.
The very first idea for the movie I had is when I traveled to the German Tidelands for the first time in my life. And I was standing where the water goes and comes away twice a day. And when it goes away, you have this huge expanse of mud and little water puddles and everything. And it looked like a very surreal landscape. And I thought, why has there never been a science fiction movie shot in this strange environment? We started to shoot there because I thought it is important for our crew and Nora Anetzeder to start in the locations to feel these elements, to feel the water, the wind and everything for real.
Tim never wanted me to see the location before shooting the scene. He wanted to keep it as a surprise. So I discovered the locations at the same time that Blake discovered them. I wasn't playing it. I played along with the discovery of it.
That was really nice.
It was clear for us very early on that the physicality of this character is very important. I wanted the strength of this character to be visible in every image that we shot with her. And we wanted the struggle that the astronaut Blake has on Earth to be also the struggle for the actress, to make it as believable as possible and as strong as possible for the audience.
On the first day of shooting, my character walked through the wastelands. And we had to shoot that scene over and over again because the way I was walking wasn't working. So he made me do it over and over again. And so I kind of discovered her physicality by just doing it.
It was a very tough shoot. She was completely soaked every day. She was like 8 to 10 hours a day in the water, and she didn't complain a single time.
There were some scenes where I was freezing, a lot of water everywhere. My fingertips turned blue at the end of the day. I remember I would stay 10 hours inside a very cold environment, but I told myself that I should never be complaining about any sort of element coming my way or any sort of difficult action. Because Blake isn't this way. Her objective is so strong that she will face any kind of obstacle. That's what I needed for the character. Any sort of uncomfortable situation is actually really helpful for a performance.
That was the great thing about working with Nora, because she was Blake. She just kept being tough and strong. On Earth, there are the Mud People. These are the survivors on Earth that survived all of these catastrophic events that took place, and they are very much in tune with nature. They are living with these tides.
The Mud adapted to the new circumstances. They created a new language. They built new houses, new clothes.
They have this floating village, which they build out of plastic. As we know today, plastic tragically would survive hundreds of years in salt water. And they use and recycle that, what we leave behind as trash, to build their village.
I think it shows the consequences of our environmental actions at the moment. But also it's really remarkable, the industry of the Muds. They've taken these materials, which they can no longer produce, and they've reused them and recycled them.
We shot a big part of the movie in the German Tidelands, but then realized early on that we couldn't shoot the whole film there. So we rebuilt this environment with classic photo backings and the floor that looked like the Tidelands.
I was overwhelmed. You really had like the chance to really play. Like, there were 360 degrees of mud land. That was enormous.
The first time I arrived on set, it's just so amazing. It's so real. They created everything.
Action! It is both a challenge but also a gift, because it's very intense with the wind machines and everything going on.
Elements are such an important part of the movie. Water, with fog, the wind. And that, I think, helped the performances to make them more authentic and to make the audience get the feeling of this physicality by having at least these elements for real and not just standing in front of a green screen.
It's so helpful when you have a set that is 360 degrees. You can play with everything. And this is massively helpful to get into a mood of like, okay, the world is going down. We really have to find a solution.
Can you get that red case? The boy has it. Can you get it for him? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Like, when she lands on Earth and she encounters the Muds, she doesn't speak their language. She's a fish out of water.
When writing, we were making our research on what could possibly be a language that survivors in 200 years on Earth could speak. The result of this research was that most likely would be a mixture of English, German, Dutch, some French elements.
Oh, where am I from?
We worked with a linguist, Daniel Liddon, who then helped us to create that own language that actually works, and started working with the actors on how to pronounce the words.
I'm sorry, Khahar.
I spent a lot of time working with a dialogue coach and just getting the language in my body so I wouldn't have to think about it before saying a line so I could just be present in the scenes. That was one of the hardest parts for me. But once I got into it, I loved the language.
Kiknaoka. Hear them.
That's also what's strong about the performances is that you didn't know what they were saying, but you still would understand their intentions and what they wanted and their objectives. But there's a universal language, which is survival.
Myla!
And Narvik and Blake are going through similar issues, which is connection and family.
Myla, she's your sister?
Daughter.
Narvik is one of the Mud people, and she's a young mother who has a daughter called Myla, and her daughter gets taken away from her. And Blake has this journey together with her where she tries to find her daughter.
Narvik doesn't trust Blake in the beginning, but then they soon realize that they can help each other.
Blake is coming from a planet where there are no children anymore, obviously, and she comes to Earth and for the first time sees children and babies again. So they represent emotions that Blake learned to suppress.
What I loved about these two female characters is that they can empower each other. And that's really how I felt with Sarah Sophie Bustina, who plays Narvik, she's a wonderful woman and beautiful actress. And we really had each other's back when we were shooting. All the scenes that we had together, that female dynamic is empowering and inspiring. We didn't fake it.
You come. Blake then learns on her journey that there's another force, which we call the Raiders. The Raiders are some kind of army, and actually one of the astronauts of the first mission, one of her own people, is the leading force behind this organized group of the Raiders.
Welcome. We waited so long.
When Blake first meets Gibson, she doesn't really know what to think, but he represents her former life on Kepler, and they can work together. So she really believed that she can trust him and they can team up.
Stand up. They waited a long time to perform for a Kepler. And
we were lost alone this day.
But then she starts realizing he wants to use the Mud's children in order to procreate and start a new community.
She learns that when the whole Kepler would come back, they would actually enslave these people and use them for their own purposes, for rebuilding society and for making sure that the next generation is secured for reproduction.
In the end, what is Gibson's mission really? Is it to perpetuate, you know, the Kepler way of thinking, or is it to become like all humans who have power, an autocrat or a dictator? So there are many questions that are posed.
Have you noticed how hardly any of the Muds is much older than 30? We have to take care of future generations.
He argues that he could help them become more healthy and live longer. But on the other hand, what he just tries to force civilization on them.
Even if Earth is destroyed, there are still humans who try to rule and try to be stronger than others. And I think it shows like kind of a repetition which we have always in history.
There are children.
They won't be by the time our people arrive.
Ian Glen plays the character of Gibson, and it was very important for us that we try to make a villain who is as complex as possible, that you don't immediately get that this is the villain or thinks he brings a good thing to these people, civilization.
For the many.
For the many.
I talked to Tim about this, and he didn't want to demonize Gibson. There are certain things that he's had to do for himself, and life is dying on Earth currently. The life expectancy is very, very low because of the conditions, so you're trying to wrestle the planet into conditions that are going to become habitable, and that's why he's had to make some really hard, pragmatic, and what might appear cold decisions just to survive.
Ian Glen in real life is a very sympathetic man, and we had this idea that we have a villain who you actually like, and that's what he brought to it.
The bottom line is you have to like who you play as an actor. Human nature is such we're not overly critical of ourselves as people.
Ian Glen was so charming and charismatic. which is why Blake really believed that she can trust him when he tells her about what happened to her dad.
The rebellion I told you about. It wasn't the mud who led it, it was your father.
When Gibson and Blake's father land, there are two different interpretations of how to deal with the quote-unquote problem. I think Blake's father sees it as a miracle of nature and wants to protect that way of life, and Gibson is the total opposite. There is a schism, you know, between the two of them. Gibson then imprisons him because he needs his knowledge. When I auditioned for the project, it fit like a glove. I felt this emotion. I felt the loss that that man had and the emotional connection with his daughter.
Every time the second moon passes, you light a match. And wherever I am, I'll do the same. And before the last one's gone, we'll be together again.
Even though it's another worldly sci-fi context, you know, any relationship between her father and his daughter, I think, is believable. When suddenly she discovers that her father is actually within this colony, and they finally reunite. The shock and emotion of finding his daughter again made me extremely emotional. And then we worked in concert with that. Nora is one of these wonderful actresses who is sensitive and is also passionate about everything. She really wants to go for it.
Is it true? You betrayed us?
We improved quite a bit, quite a few different ways of doing it. And the emotion was always there. Nora's so open and so ready to go there.
15 years I waited to hear from you, and you gave up on me?
You have an objective, and then the emotion comes later. That's not something that you really can control. If the character has a very clear objective, try to see if there's a possibility of life on Earth, and find her father, and then the emotion comes to her.
I'm sorry.
I think that there were very few words exchanged, but you know, sometimes you don't really need a dialogue in order to express an emotion.
Whatever Gibson told you, it's a lie.
All the scenes that I shot with Sebastian, we got a real beautiful connection before we started shooting the scenes, so that really helped. And of course, I really used some personal stuff with my father.
We were both very much in tune with these emotions, with whatever we experienced, you know, in our lives as actors. I do think that when you lose your father becomes this emblematic figure. And so this emblematic figure at the end of the movie is this sort of broken man who maybe is actually a better man now that he's experienced the hardships and seen the lie. And that's what I loved about Blake's father. He finds his humanity again and he redeems himself.
Louise? I never lit the last one.
As much as Blake wanted to denounce her father, her true emotions do come out. And, you know, love surpasses all in the end.
This movie is a sci-fi film, but this is something that I think is interesting about sci-fi, is you can make people think about topics that are important right now.
Stop it!
It's a very effective thriller. But if there is an underlying message, it is look after the planet, or we might end up like this.
We're talking about an important topic that people can actually really relate in our current world, but it's also a movie about connection, about love, about friendship, and I think that's why people are gonna be feeling in touch with the movie.